Good morning and good afternoon, based on the locations you are in, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome you all to this webinar. At the outset, I must thank CIDC and Dr. Sarup and his team for organizing this unique event and the exhibition. Today, I will be speaking on the subject Construction and Infrastructure Vision of India and Role of SKI. If you see the construction industry, it is basically composed of real estate, industrial and commercial, and the most prominent one is the infrastructure construction, which consists of rail, roads and bridges, ports, airports, irrigation, dams, oil and gas transportation, and all others. The construction industry has a very prominent role to the gross value added of Indian economy, having an average share of between 7.5 to 8% in the last one decade. About the various segments, the first one comes to our mind is the real estate, which is about 80% of the real estate sector. It is of the construction sector. And then there are commercial spaces, there are retail spaces, there are hospitality spaces, and then there is a small segment of special economic zones for the export-oriented units and the industrial segment. We will come to these segments each. The first is the residential space, which is about the 80% of the real estate segment. And the current scenario is, if you see the right-hand chart, that there is a huge shortfall, particularly in the middle-income group and the low-income group. And in order to address that, the government of India has really come up with the Affordable Housing and Housing for All scheme by 2022. It is a fragmented market, many participants, and the key drivers are rapid urbanization, population growth, rise in disposable income. And the trend is that the government is really pushing the credit-linked subsidy scheme in order to fulfill the shortfall in the MIG and LIG segment. There are many technologies that are available in this particular segment. Basically, there are four strands in this Housing for All objective. First is the slum rehabilitation program. And the second one, which is the most prominent, is the Prime Minister Awas Yojana Urban and Prime Minister Awas Yojana Gramin. And both of these are under credit-linked subsidy scheme sponsored by the Ministry of Urban Housing as well as by the Ministry of Rural Development. The affordable housing in partnership with public and private sector is another small segment. And the last one is the subsidy for beneficiary-led individual house construction. In the commercial space, the current scenario is that only few players are dominating, and the chart in the right-hand side is as per the assessment by a consultant. However, these assessments were in the pre-COVID stage, and therefore all these figures can be achievable after a gap of maybe 1 or 2 years more than what has been indicated in the chart. There is the key driver of this commercial space is once again coming from the tier 2 cities, and there is a rising demand for the faster completion and rising demand for co-working spaces. The another segment which is coming up very fast is the retail space. There also the major driver is 2-tier and 3-tier cities, and there is already some merging and acquisition taking place. The case in point is the Reliance Retail, which has taken over the Big Bazaar retail spaces and coming up in a big way. And however, there is a growth of urbanization, and young population are really looking for this type of retail space, the departmental stores, etc. And the hospitality space, which has undergone a steep hit due to COVID-19 pandemic, is slowly coming up. There is a sluggish growth already there, and here also the growth is limited to tier 2 markets. And however, the travelers' expectation is there is a paradigm shift from the traditional ambience to the new construction technologies. Now I come to the major plank of construction sector, that is the infrastructure sector. The left-hand side chart shows that in last year, the national highway construction sector has got about 18% of the growth as compared to energy, rail freight traffic and cargo at the major port. So this is the sector where a lot of public investment and government is also coming up to attract private investment through attractive public-private partnership model. The one major thing that has come up is the National Investment Pipeline. This is a document brought out by the Government of India. It has already identified about more than 6,500 projects under implementation, which are going in to be on the board or in the conceptual stage. And this is worth of ₹111,00,000, which comes to, in the dollar term, about 1,496,776.77 billion in the next 5 years. This is basically predominated by energy sector, roadway sector, urban infrastructure and railways. And so far as the funding is concerned, central government will provide about 39%, state government about 40%, and the private sector will contribute about 21%. The infrastructure sector has been predominated by the mega schemes that has been announced by the government, like Bharatmala, Sagarmala, which is the port connectivity, Bharatmala is the road connectivity, then railways, metro and dedicated freight corridor, civil aviation, and Jal Jeevan Mission, that is the drinking water, supply of drinking water to each and every household. These are the, and these right-hand side gives the total investment that has been allocated. If you see the left-hand side chart, in 2019-20, the government has spent about we spent about 10 trillion rupees on infrastructure, but compared to the deficit, massive deficit in infrastructure, this amount is not adequate. And the infrastructure sector, in order to facilitate investment, the government has come out with a lot of regulatory measures, facilities. The first can be mentioned as the Real Estate Regulation and Development Act, RERA. Then there is the Model Building Bylaws 2016, then infrastructure status to affordable housing, then about the long-term financing arrangement to the infrastructure sector, there is a Real Estate Investment Trust and the Infrastructure Investment Trust. These two models have recently come up about 2 years back, and these two, since these are listed on the stock exchange, this will hopefully attract major private investment, including FDI, for which the government has already announced a consolidated FDI policy. The PPP module has become much sweetened, but still there are some risks are still to be shared by the government in order to attract the private sector. Now, based on this scenario, what are the best strategy that can be done? The strategy is that the building industry has a robust demand, as I have shown, and there is a luxury residential sector is also coming up. There is a increasing investment, as this chart shows. I will not go into the detail in the FDI, what are the sectors that FDI has come in the last one decade. And there is a huge policy support by the government, particularly in the PPP policies, the hybrid annuity method, and the build, operate, and transfer method is already giving lot of dividends. Now, the point is the construction sector has to move from the price-based model or the negotiated bid model to a value-based model. And what are the basic elements of this value-based model? This is the best technology will be available here, and the technology will be supplied by the vendor by influencing the decisions of the consumers. There is a quality assurance to be given by the vendor, and by that they will be winning the consumer's perception with the new technology, and there will be a total thrust on safety and sustainability aspect. So therefore, the construction sector has to move to this value-based model. Now, in order to see that where the steel industry is actually fitting in, this chart shows that the steel capacity currently from 142 million, it is slated to go to 300 million ton by the year 2031. The right-hand side chart shows that the infrastructure and construction, which comprises about 68% of the total steel flow. So in order to enhance the steel consumption in the country and enable the country to have a capacity augmentation of 300 million by the end of this 2031, the steel intensity in construction sector and particularly in the infrastructure sector must be enhanced by adopting the steel intensive design. For instance, in the real estate, in the housing, in the affordable housing, the steel composite technology will give, particularly the light gauge steel frame technology, will give a much higher consumption of steel per square feet, between 8 to 12 kg per square feet, compared to the current method of RCC based construction, which is giving only 4 kg per square feet. Similarly, the standard designs in the road overbridges must be implemented within the next 1 year, so that all the road overbridges which can be made steel intensive, and that is how there is a huge potential of steel consumption in the road sector, railway sector, and all other infrastructure sector. But why do we promote steel? Because steel composite construction brings in sustainability. It is lighter and faster construction. It can be reused. It can be remanufactured and recyclable. There is an innovative and elegant designs are available. It's a better thermal insulation and higher wind and earthquake resistance. However, only shortcoming in Indian construction industry is that quality fabrication at various locations is not yet available. And also the erection technologies are also required at various locations, so that it can help the construction agencies while the construction is on. The LGSF technology, I have already said about the prefab and pre-engineering segments, it must come in a big way. However, the BIS must expedite the code of IS 801 for cold form structures. And all these things will be requiring skilled manpower to operate new tools and equipment. From the supply side, the steel producers are already, they are supplying high tensile structural steels, fire resistant steels, corrosion resistant steels, coated and galvanized product, and also stainless steel, including the stainless steel bars. However, there are some big imports are still coming, and the steel producers must make these type of steel, like stainless steel, more than 1250 mm width in hot rolled and cold rolled side, the API grade pipes, hot rolled coil and plate, which are wanted in a big way by the oil and gas sector for casing pipes in more than X70 grade. Then parallel flange sections are already made available by SAIL and JSPL. The cold form sections are also available. The hollow structural tubes by Tata Steel and others are being increasingly used in airport and other construction. The high tensile wear ropes are also used for increasingly getting used along with the concrete. So supply side also, there are a lot of advances are taking place, and the demand side, in the construction technology, the construction sector is also having a value-based model approach. Then Indian steel industry will go much faster along with the growth of construction and infrastructure sector. So I end my presentation here. Thank you for a patient hearing.